Hey everyone. All right, let's walk through this together. Quest number 8. All right, so we're going to graph a system of inequalities. It's the only way to solve a system of inequalities is to graph it, because there's always, at the very least, an infinite number of solutions. I guess at least there's zero, and if there's one, there's an infinity. So anyway, here we go. I'm going to graph both of these. Let's graph the top one first. We'll graph it in green. Put a little check mark next to green. So it's got a y-intercept of negative 2. Right? We're graphing the line part. It's got a slope of negative 1. We can mark out a few points for that. And it's greater than, not equal to. Okay. So let me explain this dotted line, why it's dotted, not solid. Not just because there's not an equal to, but because the line itself is a bunch of points, and all those points represent the x and y combinations that make both sides equal. And so that's why we don't want those ones, because the points on this line make both sides equal, but they can't be equal. There's no equal to there. How should we find the blacked out half? Well, y is greater. Okay, so we're looking at we're in a vertical realm here. And in the vertical, the big numbers come from up here, and the little numbers come from down here. So we want to shade above the line, because we're looking for greater y values, which are up and not down. Let's graph this other guy in red. So it's got a y-intercept of positive 4. It's got a slope of 3 halves, so go to the right 2 and up 3. And we'll throw another dotted line down, because it is also not including the points that make both sides equal. Y is also greater in this case, so again, we shade above this line. Different color in a different direction, and so we can see the solution is right here, where the red and green overlap. Right here in Christmas land, that's where the solutions are. Not on this line, not on this line, not here, not over there, certainly not anywhere down here, just in the overlap of these two, okay? I'm just gonna give you a quick reminder of what all that means. Let's just grab a point right there, clearly in the overlap. So negative 3 comma 7, negative 3 comma 7 is what this point is. It's in the overlap of these two graphs, which means that it should work in this inequality and this inequality. Let's try it real quick. 7 is greater than negative, negative 3 minus 2. There's no parentheses there. Is 7 greater than what we get over here? Well, negative 3, negative 3 is 3, minus 2 is 1. 7 is greater than 1, right? So check. I guess we'll put a little black check mark, because this is a point worked in that inequality. Try the other one. Y, y is 7. Is 7 greater than 3 halves times negative 3 plus 4? Well, we don't even have to do a lot of math here. 4 is less than 7. 7 is greater than 4. And we're going to take this negative number, right, and add it to 4, which is going to make it even smaller. So definitely 7 is bigger than that. So check, right? So that came from the overlap, and it works in both inequalities, and that's what the solution to a system of inequalities means. We're going to solve this one using elimination. Well, the first thing I notice is it's not lined up very nicely, and while there are a lot of ways that I could line this up, and I've seen a lot of clever ways, I'm just going to take, I think, the most straightforward way and just make it look like a quote-unquote normal elimination problem. So a normal elimination problem looks like x, a y, equal sign, a number, another equation, x, y, equals a number, right? So that's what we'll make these look like. For this equation, it'd be easiest to do that if I just subtract 2x from both sides. Okay, so that equation will look like negative 2x plus 3y equals 17. This one would be easiest to do if I just add 3x to both sides. So this is going to look like 3x plus 4y equals negative 17. Alright, so now it's all lined up, looks quote-unquote normal. Now let's see, these are both, you know, this is a negative, this is a positive. So it'd be pretty simple to multiply this by a 3 and this by a 2 and get them to be opposite of each other. So this becomes negative 6x plus 9y equals 351. Okay, then 2, we get 6x plus 8y equals negative 34. We add these together. These, of course, they cancel each other out. Here we get 17y. And here we get 17. So we divide by 17, y equals 1. Okay, now that we know that y equals 1, let's go over maybe here, 2x plus 17 equals 3y, and plug in 1 for y. Okay, about to figure out what x is here. 2x plus 17 equals 3 times 1, 2x. We're going to subtract 17 here from both sides. So 3 minus 17, that equals negative 14. Divide by 2, and x equals negative 7. So x equals negative 7, and y equals 1. And we're on to number 3 back here. Using elimination again. Okay, so the reason I gave you so many different problems is I basically started with fairly simple ones and then worked our way up to more difficult ones. Like this one that we just did was a bit of a challenge. We had to get everything all lined up, and we had to not only multiply by things to get them to eliminate, but we also had to manipulate the equations to begin with. This one is a little more straightforward. I can see that if I were to multiply this guy by 3, then these would become opposite each other, right? So I'd get 15x, and then 3 times negative 3y is negative 9y, and 3 times 1 is 3. So these cancel each other out, these cancel each other out. We get 0 on this side. On this side, we get 3 plus 3 is 6. This is a false statement, okay? And in short, that means, since it's false, there's something messed up about these equations to make it not possible to solve. There are no solutions here. Okay, and the real truth about it is, these two equations are ones that, if you were to graph them, they would be parallel lines. They'd never cross. They'd have the same slope, but different y-intercepts, and they would never cross. There are no solutions. Using elimination again. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and rewrite these so that they look a little more normal and lined up. So I'm going to subtract 5y from both sides here. That gives us 6x minus 5y equals 8. And this one, I'll subtract 8x. I'm going to make sure to write it underneath the x term here. Negative 8x plus 6y equals negative 12. All right. Now to try and get these things to cancel somehow. I'm thinking I could divide this by 2, and then, but let's not bother. Let's just go ahead and get them to cancel out. We could get these both to go to 24, if multiply this by 4 and this by 3. So that would work all right. So now we have 24x minus 5y, not minus 5y, minus 20y. Minus 20y equals 4 times 8 is 32. 3 times negative 8x is negative 24x. There's going to be our cancellation. 3 times 6y is 18y. And 3 times negative 12 is negative 36. Cancel 18y minus 20y is negative 2y. 32 minus 36 equals negative 4. And y equals positive 2. So y is 2. Let's figure out what x is. I'm going to jump back to this equation right here because it already has the x term by itself. 5 times 2 plus 8, 6x equals 10 plus 8. 6x equals 18, clearly. So x equals 3. We need to divide both sides by 6. 3 comma 2. There's our solution. Okay, solve the system of equations by elimination yet again. This one's pretty straightforward. We're going to multiply this one by 3 to make this a 9, and this is going to be a negative 9. Let's see what happens. We get a 9x We get a negative 12y, so we see what's about to happen there. And on the other side we get, different from the one we did a minute ago where everything on the left canceled, we get 0 equals 0. So what this is, these two equations are exactly the same equation. You'll notice this one is just 3 times bigger than this with a negative slapped on there. So like if I were to multiply this equation by a negative 3 instead of a 3 like I did, I would get the exact same thing. I would get negative 9x plus 12y equals positive 6. They're the exact same equation. They have every solution in common. Every solution that works in this one is going to work in this one for sure. So we have infinite solutions. All right. What was that? The end of that page. Solve the system of equations by, what do you know, elimination. So, we're going to get them both to 12, I guess. So we'll multiply this by 3 and this by 2. We're going to get negative 12x plus 12y equals negative 4. No, equals negative 12. This one here is going to be 12x plus 12y equals negative 36. So we add them together. We're getting a little crunched here, so let's move it up here. We're going to add these together. We get 0x. Here we get 24y. Negative 12 minus 36 for negative 48. So y is equal to negative 4. We're going to divide by 24 on both sides. Y is negative 4, so let's figure out what x is. Maybe use the second equation here. 6x plus 6 times negative 4 equals negative 18. 6x. This is negative 24, so we're going to add 24 to both sides. Add 24, and we get 6. And x is 1, so 1, negative 4. That's it. All right, here we have a pretty simple system of equations. When the plane is flying upwind, it means it's fighting against the wind. It means the wind is subtracting from the speed of the plane. Right? So if the plane were flying 50 miles an hour, and all of a sudden this 10 mile an hour wind, okay, so here's this plane, it's flying along 50 miles an hour, it's cooking along, no wind, then the wind starts to blow. It's blowing at 10 miles an hour in the other direction. Well, all together, when we take this 10 away from this 50, the plane's going to be slowed down to 40, right? So the speed of the wind subtracts from the speed of the plane. The problem is we don't know those speeds, but we do know that concept that the plane is flying at such a speed, the wind is blowing at such a speed, and it subtracts directly from the speed of the plane. So if this is the speed of the plane, and this is the speed of the wind, then this trip, whatever the speed is, it's the speed of the plane minus the speed of the wind. What does that come out to be? Well, it comes out to be that it flies 20 miles in 50 minutes, okay? 20 miles in 50 minutes, which is very slow, very, very slow. So how fast is that? Well, it's 20 miles per however many hours this is, right? How much is 50 minutes? 10 minutes is a sixth of an hour, so 5 sets of 10 minutes would be 5/6 of an hour. So this overall speed, this trip, is 20 miles per 5/6 of an hour. So we multiply by the reciprocal, we get 20 times 6/5. We get 5 divides 20, leaves us with a 4, and 4 times 6 is 24. So 24 miles an hour, just egregiously slow for a plane. So on the return trip, though, so coming back the other way, the plane, here it is flying at its same x speed. The plane, or the wind now, is blowing in the same direction. The y speed is adding to the speed of the plane. So x plus y is equal to the new speed. What's the new speed? Well, it's 20 miles in 15 minutes. That's just 1/4 of an hour, right? So let me make sure that that's 1/4 of an hour. Multiply by the reciprocal, that's 20 times 4, that's 80 miles an hour. 80 miles an hour. Okay. And this system of equations is just so nice because it's all ones and negative ones, and these guys are already going to cancel each other out if we just add these two together. So when we add them together, we get 2x plus nothing else because the y is eliminated equals 104. So x is equal to 52. The question though is, what's the speed of the wind? So let's see, we put the x there, and x plus y equals 80, and we subtract x from both sides. 80 minus 52 is 28. So the speed of the wind is 28. So now, there's this Sanjaya, is inspired by one of the American Idol contestants from many years ago, studying the relationship between temperature and the number of students who play outside for lunch. So you might think that as the temperature goes up, the number of students who go outside to play would go up as well, and when it's colder, more of them would opt to stay inside longer. So Sanjaya records the temperature at lunchtime as an input, and the number of students outside as an output. Which statement best describes the situation? Okay, so you can see all four of these selections have to do with the domain. So, okay, we just have to decide what the domain is. What's the domain? What's doing the causing? What is the independent variable here? What does not depend on the other thing? Well, you can tell by the situation that the students are standing there at the door and they're feeling the temperature outside, and so whether they go outside, it depends on what the temperature is, right? So the temperature is that input. The temperature is that deciding variable, that independent variable, the domain. So the domain is the temperature. So we can get rid of these right away and cross those out. Those aren't going to be right. The domain is not the number of students. The students don't determine the temperature. Okay, and so is temperature a kind of thing that's continuous or discrete? Well, look at a thermometer. It doesn't jump around from one temperature to another, right? It's got all these markings here, and that mercury or alcohol or whatever kind of thermometer you're looking at, it's going to be able to be anywhere in here. It might be 30, it might be 40, or it might be absolutely any decimal in between 30 or 40. So it's continuous. So there we go. The domain is temperature, and it's continuous, not discrete. Number 9, find the domain and range. Okay, so the domain is all the inputs, so we'll find domain along the x-axis, and the range is all the outputs, so we'll find those along the y-axis. So let's find all of the inputs. Here's one at 0. There's a point there. It has an input of 1. This point has an input of 2. This point has an input of 3. Okay, now for the range. Okay, so let's start, just list them in order for no particular reason. This point has an output of 0, this one has an output of 2, this one has an output of 4, this one has an output of 6 up here. So there we go, domain and range. Use a table to write a function that relates x and y. Okay, so let's fix that weird thing going on. This is going up by 3, 3, 3. This one's going up by... going up by 7, 7, 7. Okay, so that's our rate of change. That's our slope. We have a slope of 7/3. 7/3 times x, right? Our slope is always times x, plus our y-intercept, which we can see because we're already given an x of 0. The y-intercept is -2. So there we go. There's our equation. Use a table to write a function that relates x and y again. So this guy's going up by 3, 3, and 3. This one's going down by 2, down by 2, down by 2. So this one is going to have a negative slope, right? So this goes up by 3, this goes down by 2. And that's consistent throughout all of the changes here. So we have a slope of -2/3. We multiply that by x, the y-intercept of 0, so y equals -2/3 x. That's it. Next page. Here, like I said, all the choices will not be used, so for some reason I messed these up. F, G, and H, of course, would follow alphabetical order. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Okay. So relationship that pairs each input exactly one output, right? Exactly one output. That's what we stress many times about a function. The set of all input values of a function, we just covered that in the temperature versus number of children problem. The set of inputs is called the domain. So the domain, a function. The variable that represents output values of a function. A variable that represents output values of a function. But the output depends on the input, right? The input decides what the output's going to be, so that's what we call the dependent variable. The variable that represents the output depends on the input, so that would be the dependent variable. A function that has a constant rate of change, okay? So it's not just a function, it's a special function, a function that has a particular kind of rate of change, a steady one, a constant one. So that would be a linear function, right? That means just what we saw here in these two tables, right? X goes up by 3, Y goes up by 7, 3, 7, 3, 7. It's constant. The rate of change between Y and X is constant, okay? We'll see on another problem here that's not the case always. So this constant rate of change, that's a linear function. The set of all output values of a function, that would be the companion to the domain, that would be the range, E, the range. Okay, so does this table represent a linear function or a non-linear function? Okay, well, if it's a linear function, then the rate of change between Y and X is consistent. It's the same every time, right? So let's look at X. X goes up by 2, again it goes up by 2, again it goes up by 2. So if this is a linear function, then this is going to go up by, you know, 4, 4, 4, 4. But we'll see it goes up by 4, now it goes up by 8, now it goes up by 16. You might call that doubling, right? 4 times 2 is 8, 8 times 2 is 16, 16 times 2 is 32. That is not a constant rate of change. The ratio of this change to this change is not the same, right? So it's non-linear. Okay. Does this graph represent a function? Explain. So, well, just go back to the definition of a function that we talked about here, right? A relationship that pairs each input with exactly one output, that's f. What was that? That was a function, right? Exactly one output for every input. So this function, let's see, is there any input that has more than one output? Let's look at this guy right here. Well, here's the input. It looks to be about 2. Its output is about 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's close to 10. Seems to be fine, but look at this input. This input right here has this output. It also, if you keep going vertically, has this output, right? So yeah, tons and tons of inputs that have more than one output. So is it not? It's not. Why? Because inputs exist which have multiple outputs. That's why it's not a function. Okay, if there were another graph here and that weren't true, every input only had one output, then it would be a function, right? Let's see, I think that's gonna take us to the answer key, and that's it. So thanks as always for watching this, and please let me know if you have any questions.